trouble.
He's quick.
I believe in Jerry. I'm just not so sure that Jerry believes in Jerry.
I started training for MMA back before MMA was even thought about in Illinois. I just did a lot of martial arts, a lot of jiu-jitsu, probably 4 or 5 years before MMA ever came around here. So I've been in a long time.
MMA's changed my life and it's made me a better person. I'm a better fighter. I'm a better father. I'm a lot more disciplined in a lot of aspects. You know, a lot of people won't see that, but you know, I see it. Then there's another side of me that just, I don't know. I think about other things and I think it kind of beats me up. I beat myself and it shuts me down. Number one would be the death of my brother. That's the worst, I guess. I think about it every time I fight, because I know that if he was alive, he would be in my corner every time. And vice versa, we'd be fighting together. It's been 10 years and I still don't know how to cope, I guess. I mean, how does anyone let that go? It's just hard to deal with. Because it was the one day that he wasn't with me. We were together every day, but that one. And if I'd have been there, it wouldn't have happened. His friend was driving and they were on their way to his house and his friend ran a stop sign, SUV hit on my brother's side, 7 miles an hour. Killed him instantly. Actually passed the wreck on my way home. Didn't know it was him. If only you'd have been 10 minutes earlier, you'd have ran into him for the last time. He's why, no matter how shitty of a record I have, no matter how shitty I do in the cage, I won't quit. I don't care how hurt I am. He's why I fight. It's hard to mess with a fighter with nothing to lose. But if I could just get past that, and I'm in the cage, I'd be such a totally different fighter.
Game is very, very important. You have to get into that zone to walk to the cage, to get the Vaseline put on your face, and then to lock a door with another human being behind you. Because they lock that cage up, and then it's seconds before you are fighting. And it feels like you're fighting for your life. Behind the scenes before a fight, It's usually you get to see about the most nerve-wrecked human beings on this earth.
Those taping of the hands, getting everything ready, going over the last few minutes drills, getting some warm-ups in to get loose.
We're getting the doctor checking you. You can tell that your heart's going a little bit harder, and you can tell he looks at you and he's like, "You all right? Oh yeah, I'm good. I'm good." That's just how it goes. You have cameras back there. You have guys coming over there congratulating on your last fight or telling you like, "Hey, you should try this move on here. I've heard he's weaker at this, blah, blah, blah." You know, the little hearsays. It's interesting.
Don't make me stop the fight. I hate stopping fights, man. I like the fighters to decide who wins and who loses, okay? Don't make me tap for you, okay?
Hey guys, all I ask, if you know you're caught in a chokehold, do you and me both a favor. Tap out. If you go completely out, there's no guarantee I'm bringing you back, okay? I'm not God. That means you've gone without oxygen long enough that your body has turned off.
My name is Douglas Brown. I'm a physician for 618 MMA, the ringside physician. My job is to basically protect the fighters at all costs. I go through a basic history, any major medical problems that they may have. Secondly, I do a physical on him to determine that he has no heart defects that I can detect, no lung defects. I do a quick neuro exam to get a status of his neurological status. I have him follow my finger. It checks a bunch of cranial nerves in the head to make sure that they're all intact there. I'm snapping my fingers to check their hearing, to make sure those nerves are intact. They squeeze my fingers, make them go through some other fine motor skill tests just to make sure that they are physically capable to fight and their safety is protected.
Squeeze my fingers.
Brandon Taylor's, that name speaks for itself.
Brandon is every promoter's dream.
Good fighter.
And when I think Brandon Taylor, I just think Hollywood.
He's a good, strong fighter.
Athleticism.
A lot of heart.
He's a beast, man.
I've seen him train a couple times. Hard worker, could be a really good fighter.
Growing up, I had a couple holes in my heart, and I have an adrenaline disorder where it pumps, I guess, a little bit harder than normal. So I was in a wrestling meet in Muskoka when I was in high school, and I went for a slam, and my adrenaline just went, and I went to slam, and I just remember, and I just fell back.
They called me around 11 o'clock at night and told me that Brandon had collapsed, and he was in a hospital in Belleville. So we went over there to Belleville, and they told me that my son had two holes in his heart, was born that way. I didn't know. And so that he needed surgery so that they could cover those two holes. It was devastating for me because it was a life or death. So I asked the surgeon if he would pray with me so he could come out of it. And sure enough, a few hours later, he made it through. And I was so happy. I felt that God had answered my prayers, and I told him then that I would do anything, anything to support my son, whether I liked it or not. And I've done that ever since.
They put a little metal device, it's like wire mesh in there so the tissue could grow in there. The only problem now is that my heart is 2 times the size of a regular heart, about 1.5 to 2 times the size. I've already went through the whole you could die situation in your life, you know? So getting in a cage ain't that scary. The mentality that I have in the ring is that when I'm in there, it's just, I look across and I see him right there at the other side of the cage, and I just feel like he's trying to take everything from me. He's trying to make everybody in that building make me look bad. I mean, he's wanting to, you know, put me to the ground so he can have his hand raised, so he can be better than me. Nobody's better than me in my mind when I'm in there. Nobody's better. And I look at it as almost an insult that he would even think he's good enough to be in there with me, to even step in the cage, and I just get angry at him for even thinking so. So I just want to destroy him in front of everybody and make him look pathetic.
The mentality I have when I'm in the cage is pretty much, I feel like I'm unstoppable. You know, I don't care who I'm fighting. I don't care if it's the UFC welterweight champion. I feel like I'm gonna win. You know, I go in confident. You know, I train hard, so there's no reason I shouldn't feel like that.
Garrett Gross.
Garrett Gross has a ridiculous work ethic.
Monster. That dude is a beast.
A terror in the ring.
Garrett Gross is a beast.
The man.
And I see him going pretty far cage fighting.
You're not gonna beat him. You're not gonna outwork him. You're not gonna stop him, you know, unless he's done, if he's dead. I mean, that's the only way. He's just an animal.
MMA has changed my life in a lot of ways. I got into some bad stuff hanging around with the wrong people. From a young age, probably middle school, I started drinking, and then I got to high school. I started using marijuana my freshman year and continued to drink. My junior year, I was introduced to cocaine, so I started using cocaine. And I got addicted to it. I ended up going to rehabilitation my senior year of high school. It was a 28-day program and didn't complete it. So I came home, finished my football season, then dropped out of school, started using again, started hanging out with the wrong people, moved out, started selling drugs, got busted selling cocaine and marijuana, and got on probation, got a DUI after that. So I started having all these little things start piling up. Then one night I got intoxicated, and me and a buddy robbed somebody's apartment and got caught, and I did 6 months in impact incarceration program, which is kind of like a boot camp. And it really woke me up. I had been training before all that, and I thought, you know, that I was serious about it, and I was doing it 50%. Now, when my mind's clear and I can actually, you know, see what's going on, like, I start realizing all this stuff, and my life's completely different, sober and clean. I know that I can't ever go back to that. Definitely can't do that.
The fans and spectators of the sport, they're neat.
Oh, it's one of those sports where you literally get everything from the fans. What other kind of sport are you gonna get where you can go in and have a guy in front of you try to do your worst to him and then people just clap? Usually you go to jail and have to freaking pay like $1,000 fine, so it's pretty cool.
I love the fans and the spectators, it's just they hate me.
My last fight, I actually went off on fans in the cage. My area got kneed. I had to stop. I felt I couldn't continue.
When they started booing me, I grabbed the mic from Dave. He asked me nicely not to cuss. And I told them, basically, why don't any one of you drunk people get in the ring or in the cage, get kneed in the groin, and see if you can continue.
That's the only thing I don't like about the fans is when you hear him booing some guy and he's risking his life for you guys. So no matter what, you know, don't boo a guy. Without pulling any punches or sugarcoating anything, a fighter, when he steps in that cage, he's taking the ultimate risk. He's risking his life. When he steps in that cage and that door closes behind him and he squares off and that referee says it's time to fight, there's no guarantee that he's ever going to walk back out of that cage.